another edition of the Verde Valley Experience. I'm your host, Jennifer Cohen. Oh boy, today's show is all about being out of doors. Now, whether it's being out in the wilderness, out in the garden, or even perhaps just outside of your body. Very interesting show for you today. Our first guests today are Robert Frisconi and Leslie Turek, along with Leela and Hogan. Bob and Leslie are in the studio to discuss the Hug-A-Tree program. Now, this program was developed to educate children in a few of the most basic and vital survival principles. Many children are alive today because of the experience with the Hug-A-Tree and Survive program, so you'll hear all about that. Then, Robert and Leela Frisconi will be joined by dog handler Rose Ortiz and Chulo to share with us the details on Yavapai County's volunteer search and rescue dog team. They'll explain what it takes to make a certified search and rescue dog and how you can get involved. And Bob has even written a delightful children's book chronicling his dog Leela's rise to SAR certification. Very cute, and you'll see that. Our next guest will be Luna Star Venata, a Reiki master, spiritual counselor, and intuitive who has been having out-of-body experiences since she was 16 years old. Luna has been so kind to agree to come on the show and speak with us. With a master's degree in metaphysical science, Luna is well prepared to share with us the details on astral travel, remote viewing, and out-of-body experiences. Then we'll have with us Jackie Clark, the master gardener and chair of this year's 16th annual Arizona Highlands Garden Conference, which is happening on Saturday, September 19th at the Dubois Center at NAU. The conference features keynote speakers and topics that include composting, roses for high country, rainwater harvesting, monarch way stations, gardening and food safety, composting, geraniums, organic pest control, and so much more. Really cool stuff there. Then we'll take a trip out to Rimrock to the Wolf Sanctuary at the Medicine Wheel Lodge. Now, the grounds of the Spiritual Day Lodge are an ancient sacred gathering place for Native American tribes and a historic stagecoach stop. Very cool property. We'll meet with the owner, a wonderful woman named Healing Wolf, and she'll introduce us to her family of rescued wolves. Plus, we'll find out how you can get a chance to support and interact with these amazing magical creatures. And we'll finish up our show today with the return of Bob Frisconi, this time as the musician. I know, this man does everything. Bob has a self-proclaimed quirky style of music that he bets you'll never have seen the likes of. So I'm intrigued. How about you? Stick around. You'll want to see this for yourself for sure. So let's go ahead and get started. We have with us Mr. Robert Frisconi. Thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome.
Leela. We also have Leslie Turek and the wonderful Hogan down there on the floor. Thank you so much for joining us today. This is a lot of fun. I see Hogan's really excited. Yeah. Look at that face. That is awesome. Now, Leslie, you are one of the primary instructors for the Hug-A-Tree program in our area. You're also a former teacher. That pretty much lines you up perfect for that spot.
That's right. It does. The skills that I used in the classroom just transfer very easily to going before classrooms of young students and library summer programs we've taught and Boy Scout troops. It's the same skills, just a different message.
Well, sure, definitely. Mm-hmm. And Bob, you are the co-instructor for the Hug-A-Tree program in the area.
Yes, I do some of the some help. I mm-hmm. give little tidbits of information now and then. And at the end of the program, we do a demonstration with the children of how our dogs do search and rescue work.
Sure, I bet. I bet they love that. The kids just love
yes,
that.
Yes, it does.
The kids really enjoy that. In fact, we received letters from some of the students and some of the presentations we did mentioning dogs' names and how much they enjoyed the dogs.
For sure. Now, for someone who hasn't heard of the Hug-A-Tree program, Leslie, can you explain what is the Hug-A-Tree program?
Well, the Hug-A-Tree program was started in by a man in Southern California who had firsthand knowledge of a loss of a search victim, young boy over in Southern California, and it's now sponsored by the National Association of Search and Rescue. We follow their syllabus and teach the principles to kids. Don't go away from campground or home or any school ground without telling an adult where you're going. Mm-hmm. And if unfortunately you would find yourself lost, to stay put. To the concept that children remember is to hug a tree.
Certainly.
Stay put. Don't panic. Don't run. And we will find you. Our large group of volunteers will find you.
That's good. Yes, you don't want to panic. Hugging a tree is a wonderful thing. It's very calming if you haven't tried it. Go outside, hug a tree, try it. It's calming. And really, because if you panic and you start walking in a direction, chances are you're not going to be walking in the right direction. You could be miles from where you need to be. Staying put is the key.
Exactly.
And yes, it is.
Yeah, and that's wonderful that you guys run this program. So tell me, where do you go? How do you promote this, Bob?
Well, we promoted one of the ladies, unfortunately she couldn't be here today, Linda May. She schedules some of the meetings that we have at the elementary schools. We've given it at libraries. We've been to Chino Valley Library. We've been to Cottonwood Library.
Prescott Valley Library
and several of the schools in the area. I think we've instructed 900 children.
Oh, wow. 900 children and the adults, all told, wow. since April. Right. And during the presentation, at the end of the presentation, we give a little packet to each youngster that contains a whistle, mm-hmm. A little poncho to protect from weather, and a little disc that can reflect the light so mm-hmm. that they could be seen from the air or from a distance. And these resources have to be donated to purchase these things. So we're
excellent
always,
segue.
Yes,
wow.
We're always looking.
Where do your donations come from?
Well, we have a grant that started the whole program from an anonymous donor from the Valley.
Wow.
That gave us the kickstart that we needed. But any amount of donation in any small, medium, large amount is appreciated to provide these packets that
right,
we give out.
For the materials mm-hmm. that you give out. I mean, that's expensive, printing and
exactly.
all that stuff, for sure.
Yeah.
Now, as far as running the program, it's a volunteer position for you guys to volunteer and go and speak about this?
Yes, we are volunteers on the search and rescue unit. We work for the sheriff under his auspices, and all of our members are volunteers. So the Hug a Tree program is just part of our duties now, that we consider them something important to relate to the children. We'd mm-hmm. prefer not to have to search for them.
Right.
And this program teaches them, if you do get lost, basically stay in the area, hug a tree, mm-hmm. and we will find you much quicker.
Right.
The statistics show that if somebody were to start walking, an average person, if you were to walk from a place, we call it the place last seen, and they were to walk, say, a mile in 20 minutes, well, if they were able to walk for 1 hour, we would now have 27 square miles to cover mm-hmm. if we didn't know what direction they were in. So if they were just to stay in the area, if they found they were lost, they didn't know where they were, we'll find them much quicker.
Right, for sure. Now, this program is specifically designed for children age 7 to 11. However, it works on everybody. It works on children who are younger, and of course, it works on adults, too.
Yes.
It's not really age-specific, but the program itself is designed and geared toward communicating towards the younger child, because unfortunately, they do get lost.
Yeah.
Often.
Exactly. But the parents that have been accompanying all the kids that we've reached out to since April, one parent heard us at the Prescott Valley Library and called up Linda May and wanted us to come to to a Cub Scout program. I mean, they're listening too and they're hearing and we have a wonderful video that we play during the
yes.
program that really gets the message across. And like Bob said, the demonstration of the dogs really gets everybody going.
Oh, yeah.
They enjoy that
I
so
bet.
Much.
For sure. Everybody loves to see the dogs because, mm-hmm. yes, if they're needed, the dogs will get in on the action. But they really won't need too much of that if you hug a tree. So a really good thing to remember. Do you have anything on the schedule that you're going to go do next, do you think? Anything coming up?
Well, we're presenting, Linda and I are presenting to the Lions Club in Prescott September 9th or 10th, I believe, mm-hmm. Thursday morning. Then come school year, Linda's getting the schedule in line for us.
So I should call yeah. Linda to have you guys come out to my daughter's school and do
yes.
a presentation.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. Absolutely.
I'll be doing that. Mark my words, Linda, I'm calling you. Now, you guys can be found if you go to the ycsrt.org website. And you'll look, and there's all kinds of things in the heading. Hit the educational section, and the Hug a Tree program is going to come up there. There's a very interesting little blurb for you. There's wonderful contact information if you want to get contacts, if you want to send them a nice little email or something like that so that they can come out to your children's school or come to your children's organization or something like that. Definitely ycsrt.org. You're going to want to check that out. Leslie Turek, thank you so much
thank
for
you,
being
Jennifer.
Here. Bob, you're not going to leave that seat. This is going to
no.
be the Bob Show today.
Oh,
so.
You asked for it. Okay.
Well, thank you so much for talking about the Hug a Tree program. This
you're
is
welcome.
Very, very important, and I'm glad you guys have brought it in.
Thank
so,
you,
thank
Jennifer.
You. And we'll be right back with more of the Verde Valley Experience, so don't go away.
It's Ava and this is Tess from Do Your Selfie, where we recreate the hottest looks from today's biggest music videos.
After cleaning out our closet, we have a lot of clothes we don't wear anymore.
Like this old pile of t-shirts.
It's not garbage, it's actually a new rug.
And to make it, all you need to do is cut, tie, and glue.
Cut the t-shirt into strips.
Tie the strips into knots.
And glue the knots to the bath mat. I love it. Give your garbage another life.
And recycle.
Orkin has pest control down to a science.
When your business chooses Orkin's Precision Protection Program, you get a tailored pest control program for your specific industry and environment.
Your business can benefit from over a century of experience, training, and scientific knowledge that define the Orkin man.
Maximum protection, minimum exposure, backed by one of the industry's most comprehensive guarantees.
Choose your locally owned and operated Northern Arizona Orkin and get more than an exterminator. Get an expert.
And welcome back to the Verde Valley Experience. We are now here with Mr. Robert Frisconi and Rose Ortiz. Now we are talking about the search and rescue dog training program here in Yavapai County. Rose, you are a member and a dog handler.
Yes.
How long have you been doing that?
3 years.
3 years. Awesome. Yeah. And you have Chulo. Hello, Chulo.
I have Chulo here, 4-year-old German Shepherd.
Nice. Very nice. And how long has he been in the program? Same amount of time?
Same amount of time.
So is he your dog?
He is. He's my personal dog.
Very nice. Is that pretty much how it works? Does everybody use their own personal dog?
It's yes, it is. Like. You know, they're our pets first, mm-hmm. but we've trained them to be good search and rescue dogs.
That's true.
So, for example, when Leela's at home, she's the princess.
Oh, yeah.
She's a little bit of a couch potato, which I like at home, but when she goes out in the field, like all our dogs, they know their job.
Sure.
We put the bells on them, mm-hmm. on their collar. And they know it's time to go to work. And you see they also have their vests on.
Yeah.
They know it's time to go to work.
Absolutely. And she's ready. Look at her. You have her undivided attention.
She's looking at me. She's, what's going on here?
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah. She doesn't look spoiled at all. Well, that's wonderful. So they're your pets first. So you have a wonderful bond with them. You're truly connected. You get the satisfaction of training them to do something. But it's not every dog can do this. How do you know, Rose, if you have a dog that is going to take to this?
That's a very good question. The dog has to be highly motivated. They have to be friendly with people and with other dogs. Mm-hmm. And they have to really like to have that reward.
Mm-hmm.
It is a reward system. So when they work, they get a reward, and they're really waiting for that.
Well, sure. Who doesn't like a reward? I'll work for rewards.
Absolutely.
That's what the paycheck's for, mm-hmm. right? It's a reward.
Yes, it is.
You know, we wouldn't work without one. Why should they? For sure. Now, it takes, a year to get a dog certified?
Approximately a year, mm-hmm. yes. Not only does a dog have to learn, the handlers have to learn certain
Truly.
Skills, such as land navigation. Everybody
right.
has to be skilled in the use of a GPS. Mm-hmm. We have to be trained in, basic first aid, wilderness first aid, things like that. And you have to be somewhat well-conditioned. You don't have to be an Olympic athlete, but you have to be able to walk, and you know how treacherous the land navigation can be around here. So right. You have to be in relatively good condition.
Absolutely. Well, that's good. It keeps you fit, gets you outdoors
yes,
with your dog.
Yes, it does.
Now, these, yes, pets first, but now they are highly trained instruments. They're, they have special certifications. There's two of them. These guys, they have... They're the scent dogs, correct? Because there's
yes.
several different types. So is Chulo also a scent dog?
He is. He's mm-hmm. what we call an area search dog or an air scent dog.
Mm-hmm.
He also is certified in human remains detection.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have other dogs on our teams that are trailing dogs.
Mm-hmm. And a trailing dog is someone walks that way and they follow the scent, like we see in the movies with bloodhounds.
Yes,
exactly. Those are trailing dogs. Okay.
Yes.
And an air dog is one that obviously sniffs the air and looks for trails, or are they sniffing leaves, and is it just any kind of sniffing?
Well, primarily what they'll do is, when we go on a search, we have to put them in a position to where they're downwind mm-hmm. of somebody we're looking for. Mm-hmm. They work off lead. Trailing dog works on a lead. They work mm-hmm. off lead. And we try to put them in a position to where the wind is coming in our direction. It's called being downwind. And once they pick up the scent of any human being, they will take off on their own, find that person, come back and alert us. Every dog has a different alert. For example, Leela Small, she'll jump on me.
Mm.
Chulo, he's...
He has a bark alert.
He has a bark
specific,
alert.
Yep, sure.
And we tell them, show me, and they bring us back to that person.
Very nice. That's very nice. Now, something interesting about Leela is she's not your typical search and rescue dog.
No, she's not.
By any means. As you can see, there's a very large size difference between Chulo, who is a very typical search and rescue dog. You've got the good, strong German Shepherd, very large, good, big, giant nose for sniffing. And then you have little Leela here, who is a golden doodle, correct?
Yes, she is. She's a golden doodle. She's 1/4
Hi.
Golden retriever
yes.
and 3/4 poodle.
And she says, oh, and I'm so beautiful, too. Yes, you are. So how did Leela make the cut? Because I know that she's not the typical dog that they
no,
let in.
But she's, poodle actually is a retrieving dog. It's a working dog. They don't use them as much anymore, although they do have hunting poodles now. There are breeders who breed them for specifically for hunting, which is what their original job was.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, golden retrievers, they're retrievers also. And we find that retrieving dogs and herding dogs, working dogs like this, probably our experience is they make the best search dogs.
Sure.
Most of our dogs on the team are actually Labrador retrievers.
Hmm.
But Leela, she's a bit of an oddball, but
okay.
she's got the drive to do it.
Absolutely.
As Mr. Chulo here, who's yeah. resting nicely, but put him in the field, he's a different dog.
I bet. Yeah, the dogs with drive, absolutely. I have a herding dog mix, and I can tell her, you know, go find Oriel, or go get your toy, or let's go to the horses, and she, yep, absolutely. I say, where's your working collar? Because she has a working collar, and then she has a pretty collar. Dogs are truly, truly amazing. Now, Leela has her own book out.
Yes, she does.
The Life and Times of Leela, the littlest search dog.
And here
Bob,
it is.
You're an author, too. That is amazing.
Yes, it's, well, it's kind of funny how this came about. We were doing a certification for one of our Labrador retrievers, and after the dog successfully completed this certification, I had Leela in the car, and then I let her out, and the handler said, Leela, the littlest search dog. She uh-huh. goes, that sounds like the title of a book. Why mm-hmm. don't you write one? So I went home and I did it.
Very nice.
And so it came out pretty good. It's cute. We use
cute.
These. We have about 4 or 5 fundraisers every year because mm-hmm. we're all volunteer mm-hmm. organization. And we, you know, use the monies, of course, to buy equipment and such. And we sell these at our fundraisers.
Yeah, definitely.
So,
it's a great children's book. It's a wonderful read. The illustrations are wonderful. And it's the detailed story from puppydom, when she was just a pup, getting adopted by her
yes.
new parents, which is you and your lovely wife,
yes.
and then getting trained through and getting certified as a search dog. It's really quite lovely. So if you want to check one of those out, for sure, at the fundraisers, go ahead and pick one of those up. It's a great children's read. I really, really like it. So that's wonderful, you guys. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for the work that you're doing. I know it's volunteer. I know it's hard work. I know it costs you money, but what you give back to the community is invaluable. for sure. And I know, should I ever need your services, gosh, I hope not.
Hug a tree.
I will feel better hugging a tree and knowing that Leela and Chulo are coming for me, okay?
Yes.
Well, awesome. Bob, you'll be back. We'll see Bob again shortly.
So. Okay.
Rose, thank you so
much
for joining
us
today. Check out the Search and Rescue Dog Training Program at the ycsrt.org website again. The Yavapai County Search and Rescue, that's where you're going to check them out on their website. There's a little section under there under programs, and you'll find the Search and Rescue Dog there. So check that out. And we'll be right back, so don't go away.
Sparks from dragging tow chains could cause a wildfire, and that could be scary.
Ah, Smokey!
Only you can prevent wildfires.
I love taking care of my mom. It wasn't easy at first. She learned how to better communicate her needs.
And you learned how to not ignore yours.
I discovered how to make healthier meals.
And I discovered how much I enjoyed them.
Becoming a caregiver is a learning experience for everyone. Find articles, tips, and tools from experts and others who have been in your place. The Caregiving Resource Center at aarp.org/caregiving.
And welcome back to the Verde Valley Experience. Our guest in the studio now is Luna Star Venata. Now, Luna is a spiritual counselor, Reiki master, and an intuitive. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
Sure, and sharing your gifts with everyone. This is very, very cool. Thank you for enlightening us on this. Now, you wrote that you have been experiencing out-of-body experiences since you were 16.
That's right.
Now, can you tell us, what is an out-of-body experience?
Out-of-body experience is basically when your spirit body mm-hmm. leaves your physical body.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. And when can that happen?
Well, for all of us, it'll happen when we die.
Mm-hmm.
So
there
that's
you go.
A permanent,
good example.
Permanent time that our spirit body leaves. But it can also happen when we're dreaming. Mm. It can happen when we're in deep meditation. So, and also near-death experience.
Sure. And we most of us have had one of those, really.
Yeah.
Near-death experiences, which definitely change you.
Yeah.
But there's a slight difference between a out-of-body experience and a near-death experience, because out-of-body experiences mm-hmm. don't revolve around trauma.
That's true.
That can be a good thing.
So,
that can be a good
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, so typically an out-of-body experience, you're very relaxed. You're mm-hmm. in a very deep trance state. Your brain waves slow down. Mm-hmm. And that allows your spirit body to leave your physical body.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a silver cord that mm-hmm. connects your spirit body to your physical body. When we die, that cord breaks
mm-hmm.
and we give up the ghost. They
sure.
used to say
yeah.
someone gave up the ghost. That meant their body actually left
right.
their physical body.
Yeah, it's always interesting to hear those phrases and see, oh, yeah, that's really
yeah.
what it means, you know,
mm-hmm. yes.
like kick the bucket.
That's right.
That was a farmyard thing, though. We're not talking about farm animals, but now, what's the difference between out-of-body experiences and, say, astral travel? Because isn't
okay.
that kind of the same thing? How does
They're
that work?
Very similar. Mm-hmm. Typical astral body or astral travel would be you're planning a trip,
mm-hmm.
so you know where you want to go, you know what you want to experience, you know when you want to leave.
Mm-hmm.
So you plan that trip and you go into a deep trance
mm-hmm.
and send your spirit body out for an experience. an out-of-body experience many times is spontaneous. So you have no control over it. You just pop out.
Right. So that is a really big difference.
Yes.
Between astral travel, which is planned. You type in orbits, your spiritual orbits, where you want to go, and time and place and all that, and you choose that. Go into meditation, and then you can go there.
Exactly.
Whereas out-of-body is just kind of out of your control, so to speak.
It can just happen.
Wow. Well, that's really, really interesting. Does it still happen to you often?
Not spontaneously, no.
Ah,
no.
Now you
so
have control
always planned
over it.
Now, which is why I now teach astral travel so that people can also learn how to do it anytime they want to.
Right. I bet it can be a bit frightening for someone who is experiencing or having just experienced or whatever out-of-body experiences, and they go, whoa, what was that? Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Oh, I can understand that would be rather frightening.
Yeah. When I was 16, it was very scary. Mm-hmm. It was very scary. I had no idea it could even happen. And I was actually laying on my bed listening to Jefferson Airplane, Surrealistic Pillow. I apparently achieved an altered brain state, and that allowed my spirit body to pop out.
Wow.
It was very scary.
Where did you go?
I went out and went, oh my gosh,
out, and then
I popped back in again. And
then
a week later, it happened a second time.
Right.
So one of the things that I took away from that experience is that your brain is actually controlling whether you're in your body or not.
Hmm.
So there's four different levels of brainwave activity. So we're in beta right now, when we're consciously involved in being in our physical bodies. And then when we go into a light light meditation, we would achieve an alpha state. And so that's a lower brainwave activity. And then going a little deeper, we'd go into theta, which is like hypnosis.
Mm-hmm.
We're very much not aware of our physical bodies at that time. And then delta is like very deep sleep. So as we change our brainwave activity, that allows us to travel.
Hmm. Wow, that's really interesting. So meditation is a very good thing for controlling this type of thing. Oh my gosh. Now, tell us, there's another thing, and it's called remote viewing. Now, what is remote viewing?
Remote viewing is a military term that was given to astral travel, but it's a small segment of astral travel. It's mostly about sending your consciousness out to just receive information and bring that information back.
Hmm.
So it started in the Cold War. Russia was already doing it. Mm-hmm. United States decided they needed to also do it. So they would train military personnel to send their consciousness out to obtain military secrets and bring them back.
Wow.
And there's very structured protocols that go along with remote viewing.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's neat. So anytime I want to check on my daughter at school, I can remote view her on the playground.
You can do that.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, that would be fun. That could be handy.
It's good if you have her permission.
Oh. She would not give me that.
No,
she's spying on me.
Yeah.
So, wow, there's so many different things, and this is amazing. And you know all this because you have this amazing master's degree, and you do all this teaching.
Yeah.
Now, how long have you been teaching?
Oh, my goodness. I taught my first class in 1995.
Wow. So how long have you been in Sedona?
2 years.
2 years.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yes, yeah, so I was teaching in Colorado before this.
Colorado. Yeah. Very, very good. What's your favorite thing to teach?
Astral travel. And the class that I teach monthly at Sedona Creative Life Center is mostly focused on helping people get out of body, go to the other side of the veil, and meet with a deceased loved one.
Ah.
And they have an emotional experience. They get closure around that death.
Right.
There's a lot of tears. There's a lot of emotional healing that takes place.
For sure. For sure. Yeah. Now, have you had near-death experiences? I know you have.
I did. Yeah. I had one near-death experience when I was in my mid-30s. Died on the operating table in Wheat Ridge, Colorado, and left my body and met with God. Wonderful experience, life-changing.
Very much, yes.
Which it sounds like you all also have had one.
I have been there too.
Awesome.
Yes, I
That's
have.
Great.
Yeah, for sure. It is interesting. Most people go, oh my God. And you go, well, you know what? Something came out of that that was really great, that was really wonderful and amazing and eye-opening. So I embrace, if you have these experiences, embrace them. They're really cool. See what they have to teach you. If you want to know more, you can check out Sedona Reiki and Reading readings.com. That is Luna's website. So donut, Reiki, and readings.com. Lots of very good information. Of course, all the classes that you're teaching, they will have information on there about those. You can check out, you know, astral travel or remote viewing, which sounds fascinating because it's military. Ooh, that's just too cool. Just really great stuff. So check out the website, Sedona, Reiki, and readings.com. Luna, thank you so much for sharing us today. Really appreciate you being here. Keep doing what you're doing, too.
Thank you.
Awesome. And we'll be right back, so don't go away.
Hey, it's Ava, and this is Tess from Do Your Selfie, where we recreate the hottest looks from today's biggest music videos.
After cleaning out our closet, we have a lot of clothes we don't wear anymore.
Like this old pile of t-shirts.
It's not garbage, it's actually a new rug.
And to make it, all you need to do is cut, tie, and glue.
Cut the t-shirt into strips.
Tie the strips into knots.
And glue the knots to the bath mat. I love it. Give your garbage another life.
And recycle.
Orkin has pest control down to a science.
When your business chooses Orkin's Precision Protection Program, you get a tailored pest control program for your specific industry and environment.
Your business can benefit from over a century of experience, training, and scientific knowledge that define the Orkin man.
Maximum protection, minimum exposure, backed by one of the industry's most comprehensive guarantees.
Choose your locally owned and operated Northern Arizona Orkin and get more than an exterminator. Get an expert.
And welcome back to the Verde Valley Experience. Our next guest with us in the studio today is Jackie Clark, and she is a master gardener. What a cool thing to be called, a master gardener, and the chair of this year's annual Arizona Highlands Gardens Conference. That takes up a lot of space to say all that.
It does.
That's pretty nice.
This is the 16th annual. Mm-hmm. It is a gardening conference. It's rotated among the upper, higher elevation counties. So last year it was in Yavapai County, and they had some really good speakers. And so some of them will be at our conference. And there's topics for everybody at our conference, not just people that live up in Flagstaff.
That is true.
Our major keynote, one of our major keynote speakers is Clara Coleman, and she's from Maine, and her father was kind of the pioneer of four-season organic gardening, and he grows produce to sell all year long in Maine.
In Maine.
So Flagstaff will have some have something to learn from that, but I think anybody could pick up some tips from that and grow your own produce all year long.
Right.
And our other keynote is Judith Phillips, and she's a landscaper from New Mexico. And her message is that the climate is changing and we have to adapt our gardens for the extremes, you know.
Right.
Sometimes it's super hot, sometimes it's super cold. It's never like it was normally.
Right.
Sometimes we have more rain, sometimes we have less rain, and sometimes it's a drought, and then we have a downpour. So those are our two keynotes.
Right. But besides that, you've got lots of other things going on. I mean, you have those two wonderful ladies doing their speaking, but then you have topics on composting, which is a really wonderful thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't waste all that good stuff. Compost it. And it's not so easy, composting. It's not like you throw it in a bin and it's done.
Well, you know what's interesting is the man, Patrick Pfeiffer, that's going to speak on it, was an NAU student, and he didn't want to see all that waste on the campus, so he organized campus composting of landscape material as well as the foods.
Wow.
And he's graduated, and now he has his own company called Roots, and they pick up food waste and from the restaurants, and for $10 a month, they'll come to your house and pick it up once a week. And I actually do that because I'm like you. I mean, it's not it's not just a matter of throwing it somewhere.
Yeah, right. It's not so easy.
It's not so easy. It's not so hard, but you have to be dedicated.
Yeah, and you got to have the right equipment and the right space. And yeah, it's not just something you kind of throw it out the back door and there it goes. It's a little more challenging. Now, roses for the high country, a big one. I love roses, but I find them very fickle around here. So that would be a good program to attend.
Yes, I'm sure she's going to talk about the various varieties that work well in various places. And I love roses too, and I've had my house in Flagstaff for 17 years, and I've never planted a rose, but I've got about 14 of them.
Wow.
So they can be very hardy, let's put it that way.
Some of them can, if you get the right
one. If you get the right one.
And another one of your programs is rainwater harvesting. You know, that's those certain times of year when we get a lot of rain to collect that. It's just, you know, again, like composting, why waste it?
Yeah.
But again, not so easy.
Well, not so easy, but not so hard either, you know. But the thing of it is you have to do a few calculations to figure out how big of a container you need.
Right.
Because, like you said, we get the downpours.
Right.
So you never know. You could get a quarter of the rain that we get in a year in one hour.
Believe me, I know. And a couple of other things you guys are going to have, gardening and food safety. That's an important one. I never thought about that.
Well, her talk is going to be on the critters that might come and leave little specimens.
That's a nice term.
In your garden. And what to look for, what could be harmful, what couldn't, you know, what's okay, how to get rid of those critters, and also, and I'm pretty sure she's not going to tell you how to poison them, but I think she's probably going to tell you how you need to construct your garden and your fences to keep those critters out, and then she's going to tell you what you need to do if those critters get in and you want us to eat your tomatoes.
Right. No rattlesnakes in your radishes. And there's others like composting, geraniums. I love that. A whole section on geraniums. I love geraniums. I have very sad geraniums on my porch, so I'm glad that we're not at my house right now, because you'd be like, oh. Now, it also mentions monarch way stations. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, monarch populations are declining, and the main reason it appears that they're declining is that their host plant is milkweed, and it's a weed. And throughout the Midwest, where all the agriculture is mainly, they've poisoned it, you know, because they feel like it's competing for resources with the farm crops. And when the monarchs don't have any milkweed to lay their eggs on, the population declines. So there is a movement now to build monarch way stations, and you just plant milkweed and they'll come.
Wow.
Milkweed and then some nectar plants, like any of the sunflowers, echinacea, salvia, Russian sage.
Yeah.
I bet they love rosemary too.
Oh, I bet. And of course the butterfly bushes.
Yeah.
I have one that it smells fantastic, and it is covered with the giant tiger swallowtails right now, which are, wow, amazing. Yeah. Just gardening for butterflies alone, and you've got me hooked.
Yeah.
I would be there. Now, the 16th Annual Arizona Highlands Garden Conference is going to be held on Saturday, September 19th, at the Dubois Center at NAU. Now, it is going to happen from 8:45 until 5 p.m., The cost is $75 for those who have registered before September 8th. Right.
Good catch.
Which is coming up. Like over. So too bad. Now it's $100. But it is worth way more than that. Way, way, way more than that. So, and you can give them a call because you'll need to register. So you got to check them out at 928-774-1868, and it's extension 110. So 928-774-1868, extension 10. So you need to register. Gardeners of all skill levels are welcome at this, which is really lovely because I'm like, I would like to say I have a green thumb, but I don't. I really don't. And I You know what? I grew chard this year. I'm pretty proud of myself. I grew chard.
And that's so good for you. It really is.
I like it. It's pretty.
It is.
You know? And my tomatoes. I grew sun-dried tomatoes. That's what I grew. Tiny little nasty things.
Do you know, down in the Verde Valley, you have a different growing season than we do up in Flagstaff.
That's true.
But tomatoes don't like it much hotter than 85 degrees. So you probably need to start them a little earlier because they're going to be done pretty soon.
Yeah. Though cooking with them, I'm sure, but they're killing.
Yeah.
So everything you ever needed to know about gardening in this area for sure is going to be happening at the, I got to get this right, the 16th annual Arizona Highlands Garden Conference. So go ahead and check that out for sure. Thank you so, so much for being here. Appreciate it, Jackie.
This was fun.
You'll be there at the conference?
I'll be there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely. Well, thank you so much.
We're out of time, I know, but I'm actually giving one of the presentations.
Which one?
The self-irrigated planters.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. Well, there you go. Check out the self-irrigated planters program. And you can see Jackie Clark. It's so cool. Well, great. Thank you so much for being in the studio today. And we'll be right back. Bob's coming up with some interesting music, so don't go away.
Here is my handle and here is my spout.
When I get all steamed up, then I shout.
Tip me over and pour me out. Oh.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Cheers.
Take time to be a dad today.
I know.
Come alive with the forest.
But that was cute.
You were looking right at us.
Visit discovertheforest.org to find a forest near you.
And welcome back to the Verde Valley Experience. We are now out here in the wilds of Rimrock at the Medicine Wheel Lodge. It's the most gorgeous, gorgeous place, I have to say. It's truly a sacred, sacred spot with lots of wonderful history. And I have with me here Healing Wolf. Thank you so much for letting us into
your
sanctuary. And you've probably seen these little creatures running around. There's one parked right under that camera right now waiting for a cookie. And Healing Wolf, you have rescued and rehabilitated and raised different varieties of wolves for years now. That's an amazing, it's not something everybody does.
To me, it's normal. And I've done this since I was a child. I will rescue anything from snakes, turtles, birds, you name it. And wolves have always come to me. And my father gave me the name of Healing Wolf when I was young because he found me trying to heal a wolf that had come to me. So literally, I do get a lot of animals that actually come to me.
That's a wonderful thing. You truly have a gift.
My family says since I was a child, I just could walk in with wild animals, whether they're male cheetahs or any breed, and I believe that they sense so much love, there is a complete absence of fear. And I've always known since a child that I wanted to be a voice for animals. I want to abolish all ignorance, all cruelty, and all neglect to every animal of any kind, wild or domestic, out there. So this is a privilege.
Yeah, that mm-hmm. is truly what you guys are doing here at the Medicine Wheel Lodge. You're spreading that mm-hmm. that knowledge and using your voice and, mm-hmm. and your presence here and sharing the gifts that the wolves have mm-hmm. brought to you. Now, what is it like having a family of wolves here?
Well, they are a family, and I'm so appreciative that you said that. They're not pets. Mm-hmm. They are my children. Mm-hmm. And they come before me, my husband, yeah. or anything. But they are so loving. Mm-hmm. And when people come out, they love visitors and they love children. And they will kiss you and you can barrel hug them. They're shy around cameras, but when you're here, personal cameras are fine. Commercial, they don't know what to make of them.
Sure.
But they're very loving and they touch people on a deep and spiritual level, individually.
Certainly. It's not an experience most people get to have.
Yeah.
Being kissed and rubbed on mm-hmm. and snuggled and scratched a wolf's belly. I mean, you know, mm-hmm. I hadn't done that before today. Mm-hmm. So that's an amazing gift right there that you're bringing to the world. Mm-hmm. Now, you have these two guys here. Mm-hmm. We have Jertoma. And mm-hmm. Mahota,
yes.
That's a brother and sister.
Brother and sister.
And they've been with you since pups.
Yes, absolutely. Just a couple of months old. They are Alaskan tundra wolves.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. the difference between them and my rescues is the ones that I raise, they do not know that mm-hmm. man can be cruel.
Right.
So they have no fear. The ones that I rescue, depending upon their level of abuse, they have issues.
Mm-hmm.
I've never been able to 100% rehabilitate them because sometimes the abuse is so severe,
right.
it leaves emotional scars. Mm-hmm. But they also are loving and sweet to people. And they have taught me the gifts of patience.
Mm-hmm.
And boundaries. So
sure.
It takes a lot of patience to work with the rescue ones.
I bet. Mm-hmm. And an important thing about these guys is they are wolves. They mm-hmm. are not dogs.
Yes.
They are not a domesticated breed.
No.
So you have to work with them on a different level.
Exactly.
With a respect to what they are and not try to treat them as if they were dogs.
That's very interesting. And I'm glad you brought that out because first and foremost, I would like to state that I do not advocate owning any type of wild animal. Wild animals were created to live in the wild, and we should respect and support them as such. Again, these wolves and all my previous wolf packs, they find their way to me, and I believe they come to me to be not only an ambassador for their own kind, but to be a voice for all animals, domestic and wild.
Mm-hmm. Certainly, they are an excellent harbinger of good news for how society is shifting
our view
towards our wild animals.
Absolutely.
And our
domesticated would
animals.
Be a very empty, lonely world without the animals. And what they're teaching us is that what we don't understand, we fear.
Right.
And what we fear, we destroy.
Yes.
This is not only animals, but it is people of maybe a different culture, mm-hmm. different race, different color, different religious belief. So part of the wolf medicine is teaching us to embrace everything. And whether we're different colors, we're different religions, we're wild or domestic animals. The wolf medicine also teaches people about perseverance.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what they're going through in their life or on their path, they above all teach us about family. They love the pups and they celebrate. Only the alpha male and female will breed, but the rest of the pack will enjoy babysitting. The wolf medicine also gives us the gift of teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe every human being has something special in their soul that God placed unique to them.
Sure.
They bring out the teacher in you. So the wolf medicine has many, many what we call medicines.
Mm-hmm.
Teacher, strength, perseverance, family. Mm-hmm. They have a lot of good medicine to share.
And unconditional love as well,
oh.
and especially for you, for what that you've done, especially for Kira mm-hmm. and Dakota, who mm-hmm. are two of your rescues.
Mm-hmm.
They are. And they are the different breed, aren't they?
They are. Now, those are mixed breeds, and we have a red wolf mix, and we have Mexican gray mixes and things back there.
Sure.
But
a lot going on.
Oh, yeah. The wolves, when people come out, it opens their mind.
Sure.
Because they might be fearful, and when they see how loving they are, then it opens up their mind and consciousness. So then they can now embrace all of nature. And for some people, it's easier to connect with animals than it is with other human beings.
Yes,
so it opens
reasons.
Up their heart for
and why not?
Relationships.
Look at that face.
There you
go. So if you'd like to check out the Medicine Wheel Lodge, it's very easy. Go to medicinewheellodge.com. You have a beautiful website.
Thank
Lots
you.
Lots of wonderful information on there on how you can get the opportunity to meet these amazing creatures. And if you would like to support the Medicine Wheel Lodge and what it's doing to rescue and rehabilitate the wolves,
Chitoma.
There's all the information that you need. The contact number for Healing Wolf is there, and it's just spectacular. What can I say? A little piece of paradise here in Rimrock out in the desert. It's just gorgeous. Thank you for sharing
Thank you so much.
Us and allowing us to come in. It means a lot to us.
Well, they love company, and we appreciate you being out here, and they just would love to meet people and their family and their children's, and I can guarantee everyone will have a marvelous experience.
Oh, how could you not? Check out medicinewheellodge.com. You'll definitely want to go there first. And don't go away, because we'll be right back with more of the Verde Valley Experience.
Sometimes all it takes to be a dad is remembering how to be a kid again. Take time to be a dad today.
They'll test you. Try to break your will. But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly, you're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
As an American, it's hard to hear that we have a serious hunger issue in our country. And as a parent, it's even harder to hear that 1 in 5 of our kids struggles with hunger, especially when billions of pounds of good food are wasted every year. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide billions of meals to families in need right in your community. Visit feedingamerica.org to support Feeding America and your local food bank. Together we can solve hunger. Together, we're Feeding America.
Go find. They lost the scent. Leela, find him. Hoagie, go to work. Woo, there they go.
Get him. Find him. Woo, woo.
Found him.
That was great. Yes, Hoagie was singing there.
He had Hoagie singing there.
Yeah. That was awesome.
Oh, that was
Leela
good.
Was just soaking it up. Oh, that was very cool.
It was cool.
That was very, very cool. What would you call that?
Well, what it is, it's my rendition. It's kind of a compilation of sounds that were early recordings by some old Southern black gentlemen, early 1900s. And what they used to do is they would use their harmonica and they would imitate sounds that they would hear in nature and around town. This one, actually, I changed it up a bit. I called it Search Dog, but the name of this song, if you want to call it that, is Fox Chase. And what it's supposed to be is it's an imitation of the sounds that would happen when they were chasing foxes with hounds.
Well, sure.
So we changed it up a little bit because this is a search dog.
That's true.
Day
to day. A lot of fun. Yeah, every time you said get him, the dogs would go, what? Where? It was awesome. And yeah, he was singing along. His little lippies, he's still singing.
Yeah, we got a little barking going on in there. And
that's great.
Just kind of a little silly, kind of corny. But
no, but it's fun. How long have you been playing harmonica?
Oh, I've been playing probably for, I don't know, maybe 20 years. I mean, I started playing when I was a little kid, you know, just goofing around with it. But then I kind of got more involved with it as a hobby. And, you know, I just have some fun with it.
Well, sure.
Yeah.
You get to entertain the kids when you...
I entertain my grandchildren, and I play sometimes maybe a little too loud for my family, you know.
Music is never too loud. Who says that?
Well, it just depends. I could get a little annoying at times, but I have some fun with it,
you know. That's fun.
Yeah.
Well, you came quite prepared. I love the array of harmonicas you brought in your pouch. They're all your different keys.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we have different keys.
Great. And, do you use every single one of those?
Well, it depends. If I go, you know, one time I was in a band. I was in a blues band, and we different songs are in different keys depending on. And if you're singing a song, you know, you sing in a certain key, so you're going to have to maybe change it up a little bit.
Right.
And I've been playing lately. I go to some jams over here. As a matter of fact, I got a good one here in Cottonwood. I go to on Thursdays.
Right.
And you know, depending on the key of this, they'll tell me what key the song is, and then I grab my harp and play along.
Well, that's very cool. Any tips for someone who's thinking that maybe they want to pick up a harmonica and start playing? What's the first thing they should do?
Well, you know, there's some really great lessons on YouTube right now. You know, YouTube's they didn't have that when I was starting out, you know. And I took lessons from some very, very good instructors. Joe Felisco, Buzz Krantz, some of my old buddies. And I love these guys. They're great players.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just more of a hobbyist, but these guys were terrific, and they taught me a lot. And I would say right now you can go to YouTube, and they have lessons on YouTube, and it's
YouTube has everything.
It is. It'll really, you know, cut through it. You'll learn a lot faster.
Oh, good. And you can watch the Verde Valley Experience on YouTube, too. You can watch Bob as many times as you want by going to YouTube and checking out the Verde Valley Experience.
Or only once if you want to.
Yeah. What's the next song you're going to play?
Okay, the next one is going to be a like a train song. You know, the harmonica, of course, is the best instrument to imitate a train, okay? So let's see, we'll make up a little story here. We're gonna go from Prescott to Cottonwood, okay?
Okay.
And we're gonna make some stops along the way in PV and maybe even Jerome, and let's see how it takes us, okay? This is
very good.
Very little rehearsal. Here we go.
Well, thank you, Bob. Really appreciate it. Mr. Robert Frisconi.
Okay.
This
here
is
we
the
go.
Bob Show today.
Okay,
thank you so much for everything you've done for
You're
us today.
Welcome.
Pleasure having you on the show.
Well, thank you.
And we'll see you next time on the Verde Valley Experience.
You ready?
Yep.
Okay. All aboard. Pretty good now. going over to Prescott Valley right now. It's that stop. Oh, look over there. There's some guy playing harmonica. He's trying to pick up a couple quarters. One, two, three, four. Leaving a station again. Hey, give that guy a couple quarters, Jennifer, will you? Going around a mountain. Up Mingus Mountain, all of a sudden we stalled out. Mr. Harmonica, what's the problem here? Why aren't you chugging? You want your mommy? What you want your mommy for? You love your mommy. Well, you love your daddy too? Well, then you better start chugging, because we got to make it over to Cottonwood. We got to get Jennifer back home, okay? We're going now. Next step, Cottonwood. We made it. What do you think of that? Was that corny or what? You wanted corny, you got corny.